Good afternoon, everybody. Today we are going to discuss the new topic, that is synchronous motor. Now, first of all, let us discuss the constructional diagram of synchronous motor. As we have learned in the alternator, that the construction wise alternator and synchronous motor are same. So here let us see the construction diagram of synchronous motor, which was the same as that of alternator. Now in figure number A, we can see the second type of construction diagram. Means we have learned two types of construction diagram in the alternator, and second type was the static armature circuit, whereas field was the rotation in nature. Same diagram is used here, means type second construction diagram is used here. Here you can see that this is the inner periphery of the stator, and armature winding is placed in the stator, inner periphery of the stator, and the winding connections are given outwards to give this three-phase supply to it. And this is the rotor having north pole and south pole, which is created by the field winding, in which the DC current of value IF is made to flow to create the north pole and south pole. So field winding is excited by the DC source, as that of we have seen in alternator. So there is similar case here also. And here the load is connected with the shaft, and which is rotating at the speed of ns. So this is the construction diagram in which now we are going to supply the three phase AC voltage to the stator terminal, because it is a motor, and in the motor we have to give the electrical power as the input, and output will be the mechanical loading. So mechanical load is at the output side, and at the input side electrical supply. And if it is a three phase synchronous motor, then we will give three phase AC voltage at its input terminal. And whenever there is a three phase voltage is applied to the distributed armature winding, there will be rotating magnetic field, which will rotate at the speed of ns in the air gap. So here is also a rotating magnetic field, which is rotating at the speed of ns. And after this, suppose we have applied the DC voltage to the field circuit, and north pole and south poles are created on the rotor. And now let us see what will happen to next when the supply is AC supply is given at the stator side. And because of this AC supply, there will be rotating magnetic field in the air gap. And when we are going to give the DC supply, there will be north pole and south pole on the rotor. The stator is stationary, but the field created by the stator winding will be rotating at the speed of ns. Now the speed of stator field is ns, means it is at the synchronous speed in rpm. Now at the first instant, suppose this is south pole and this is north pole, which is rotating, revolving in this fashion, and at this instant north pole is in front of south pole, and north pole of stator is in front of south pole of the rotor. So there will be force of attraction on this rotor because of this revolving stator field. But next instant, because this stator field is rotating very fast, it is at the speed of ns. So in the next instant, here as shown in figure C, there will be north pole of the stator and south pole of the stator at this place, whereas in the earlier instant south pole was here, and the next instant north pole will be here, because it is rotating very fast rotation. So instantly change the location of the poles, rotating poles. But because of the inertia, this rotor will not rotate, because at the first instant this north pole is going to attract with the south pole of the stator field, but next instant north pole will repel this north pole, so the torque will be in anticlockwise direction, whereas in the case B torque was in the clockwise direction, and it is too fast that because of the inertia this rotor will not rotate at all, because at the first instant there is a force of attraction and rotor tries to rotate in the clockwise direction, and in the next instant rotor there is a force of repulsion and rotor tries to rotate in the anticlockwise direction, and again there is a next instant like this. So because of the inertia rotor will not rotate, because the rotating stationary rotating armature field is very fast and rotor can't follow him because of the inertia of it. So we can say the average starting torque is zero at the first instant, torque is in clockwise direction, and the next instant torque is in anticlockwise direction. So average starting torque is zero. It means synchronous motor is not self-starting. This is a very important conclusion, that synchronous motor is not self-starting. It means, suppose we want to start this synchronous motor and we have just applied given the supply, three-phase AC supply, and this is applied to the rotor, and we are looking at the motor that it will run. No, it will not run, because every starting torque is zero, and hence we can say synchronous motor is not self-starting, because at the first instant the rotor is filling the torque in the clockwise direction, and in the next instant rotor is filling the torque or force in the anticlockwise direction. So every torque is zero. And why this is going to happen? Because of the inertia, rotor cannot instantly catch up this rotating field. So average starting torque is zero. Now suppose by anyhow we have made an arrangement that this rotor is now rotated by some external means, and it is attached with the rotating magnetic field. By anyhow or by any method, we have made an arrangement to rotate this rotor also, and it is attached with the rotating magnetic field in normal operating condition. So we have to make some different arrangement with the shaft, so that will rotate this shaft, means this rotor will rotate it, and at speed nearly equals to ns we will excite the DC voltage, we will excite the field winding using DC voltage, and that will catch the rotating magnetic field. And now once it is catched, or it is synchronized, means the rotor is also now rotating at the speed of ns. But mind it, the inherently synchronous motor is not self-starting, but we have make an arrangement to make it rotate by some external means or by some external motor that will rotate this rotor, and after rotation we will excite this field winding that will create the north and south pole, and this when the speed is nearly equal to ns and we are exciting with the DC source, then this north pole and south pole will catch the rotating south pole and north pole, and this rotor will also now will be in synchronous. So when there is a synchronism and there is no load on the motor shaft, then we can learn that the rotating north pole of the stator will be attached with the south pole of the rotor. North pole of the stator, south pole of the rotor will be attached using, we can say, there will be a magnetic coupling between the rotating field and the rotor. and that may be think of like springs are connected between the field, rotating field, and between the rotor. So these springs are analogous to magnetic coupling, means there is a magnetic coupling of rotor with the rotating magnetic field like this. Means suppose this south pole is attached with the north pole of the rotating field, and this north pole of the rotor is attached to the south pole of the air gap field. So this rotor will be moving with the same speed as that of stator field. You may consider either in clockwise or in anticlockwise, whatever is the condition. In this diagram, in diagram number A, I have considered that field is rotating in clockwise direction. In this diagram C, I have considered that suppose field is rotating in anticlockwise, then rotor will also rotate in anticlockwise. There is no matter. But the important thing is there is a magnetic coupling between the south pole and north pole of the system. Similarly, there will be, and this magnetic coupling may be think of like springs are connected, and this is the at no load condition. Now suppose we have attached some mechanical loading on the motor shaft, what will happen? The rotor, which was rotating with the same or with the equilibrium condition, and because of the loading, this rotor will slightly lag behind this mean position because we have attached some loading on the rotor. Because of this attachment of the loading, this rotor will slightly lag behind the equilibrium position. Means the position must be at this, but this will be lag behind this position. And now at this condition, the stator is rotating at NS, and rotor is also no doubt rotating at NS, but it is lagging behind this mean equilibrium position because we have attached some extra load or some load with the rotor. Now think, what will happen with these analogous magnetic coupling or this spring equivalent to magnetic coupling? The spring will feel stretching, and because of this there will be a force in this direction. Suppose you are stretching the spring, then there will be restoring force in this direction. So this force will be going to apply on the rotor, so the rotor will feel a restoring force in this, in the direction of rotation. And what will happen, let us see. But before that, we will learn what is this delta. Means sudden application of the load will lag the rotor position, and that load is, that delta is known as load angle or torque angle or power angle or coupling angle. This is very important. This is very important term, delta. So delta is load angle, torque angle, power angle or coupling angle. So because of this restoring, the rotor will feel a restoring force, and because of this force, this rotor will going to tends to move in the direction of restoring force. So after a moment, this rotor will move slightly ahead than this mean equilibrium position. Then this mean equilibrium position means now rotor is at ahead of this mean equilibrium position, and now spring will be stressed in opposite direction. Again there will be restoring force that will be in the opposite direction of this restoring force, so the rotor will feel another restoring force in backward direction. Again going back, then feel forward direction, backward direction, forward direction. This will happen, means like this. And mind it, both rotor and stator field both are rotating in nature. Rotor is also rotating, field is also rotating, but the rotor vibrates with its mean equilibrium position. Rotor vibrates with its mean equilibrium position in the direction of rotation, and that is known as hunting. So the phenomena involving the oscillations of the rotor about its final equilibrium position is called hunting. This is called hunting. Now, what should we do? First thing, there must be very much clear in our mind that why there is hunting, because we have applied a sudden change in load, or we have applied a load, suddenly we have applied a load to the motor, or suddenly we have changed the load. Suppose there was some amount of load and we have suddenly removed that load from the machine, or there is a fault in the supply system. Because of the fault, there is a disturbance in voltage and torque, in sudden change, or there is a sudden change in the field current. Suppose you are giving the field supply to the rotor circuit through the field winding, and there is a sudden change in the field current. Suppose you have increased suddenly the field current, value of the field current, or reduced the value of field current, or there is a load which contains harmonic torque, means the load is not constant, it is varying with respect to time. Suppose your motor has the load like the loading on the lathe machine. Whenever there is an object or workpiece, there will be loading on the machine. When you have done your work, completed your work on the lathe machine, the machine will come on the no load condition. So when you will be going to apply on the going to apply your next object on the lathe machine, nobody knows. So whenever there is a load which changes very frequently with respect to time, or that we may call that has the harmonic torque, and because of that there may be oscillations with the mean position. So these are the various reasons or causes for the hunting. And because of the hunting, there are certain issues with the machine. Because of hunting, there are certain issues with the machines, means it produces severe mechanical stress on the rotor, right? And there may be fatigue in the shaft, or stress on the shaft, means once it is rotating clockwise, then anti-clockwise, again clockwise, anti-clockwise, there may be stressing in the shaft, as well as there is maybe fatigue or fatigue failure in the shaft. In certain cases, the shaft may break down. Second, because of these oscillations, there will be great surges in the current and power, means there will be fluctuation in the power and current because of these oscillations. Surges means suddenly rise or suddenly fall in the voltage or current or power. And because of this, the losses will going to increase, and hence the temperature of machine is also going to increase. These are the bad effects of the hunting. First, we have learned what are the various causes of hunting. Then we have learned what are the various bad effects of hunting. Now, what can we do that this hunting should be prevented? So for prevention of hunting, we may use the flywheel on the shaft of the machine. What will that do? Whenever there is a change or variation, the flywheel will absorb the additional power, or may release some extra power as and when required. And second point, use of damper or amortizer winding. Let us see what is this. And third point is by designing the synchronous machine with suitable stiffness factor. Means in the designing, while designing, we may consider this point into the taken into the account that okay, whenever there will be hunting, the machine should behave in such a manner that overall there is no any loss because of this hunting. Now let us come to second point, by using damper and amortizer winding. What is this? This is a winding which is placed near the pole face, and this is the winding which is placed near the pole face like this, and short circuited at the end, short circuiting at the end. So in the another diagram you can see that these jumper windings are short circuited with the each other also. So there is a completely casing because of this jumper winding. This is placed at the pole face, near the pole face, in addition to this additional the construction diagram. Means here it is placed the jumper windings, and that is short circuited at the end, like this short circuited at the end. So what will happen because of this? Whenever there is a mean equilibrium position, the field winding that was here, there will be no any flux cutting. But whenever there is a movement of this winding, whenever there is a movement of this rotor and flux was coming, there will be flux cutting, and because of flux cutting, the rotor flux cutting by these jumper windings. And whenever there is a flux cutting, there will be induced EMF, and this is a closed circuit because of ending short circuiting. So the current will flow, and that current will oppose the very cause. Again, there is a Lenz law. What is the cause? Cause is the flux cutting. What is why? Because why there is a flux cutting? Because of there is a movement. So ultimately, the torque produced by the current induced will oppose the movement of the rotor about its mean equilibrium position. So it will damp out the oscillations or hunting. Hence, these windings are known as damper winding. Means these winding will damp out the oscillations about its mean equilibrium position because of the Lenz law. So these windings will come into the picture only when there is a hunting. If the machine is running perfectly in synchronism with the rotating field, there will be no role of these field damper windings, because damper windings comes only when there is a flux cutting. In perfectly equilibrium position, there will be no any flux cutting. And now, if we plot this delta with respect to time, then what will happen? If there is a no damper winding, then there will be constant oscillations in the rotor. And with respect to time, if we measure, this will be the plot, the variation of load angle after sudden change or sudden loading. But if we have used the damper winding, what will happen? The oscillations will be reduced, and finally it will be settled down because of the damper winding torque, the torque produced by the damper winding. So we can say that whenever we are going to use the damper winding, the oscillations or delta will going to reduce to zero. But if we have not used any damper winding, only there is no any damping, then rotor will continuously rotate or oscillate with the mean equilibrium position. So this was the hunting and damping of oscillations. And once we have test the damper windings, there will be now no hunting in the synchronous mode. So now let us come to the next point. What are the starting methods of synchronous motor? Because we have seen that synchronous motor inherently is not a self starting motor. So we have to adapt some starting methods. The very first is by using auxiliary motor starting. Means synchronous motor is attached with certain small rating induction motors, that is also known as pony motors or auxiliary motors. So first we will start the induction motor is self starting, that will rotate the synchronous motor. And when the speed of synchronous motor is almost near to the synchronous speed, then we will excite the field winding, and that will going to attach with the rotating magnetic field. And now we can say the machine or motor is in synchronous. Second important method is starting by the damper winding. Yes, the damper winding has even advantage that it was used to damp out the hunting or damp out the mean oscillations or oscillations in the machine. And second advantage of this damper winding that it is now behaving like a squirrel cage induction motor. Yes, it is like behaving like a squirrel cage induction motor. Just think about this winding now after connecting each other. Now this damper winding behaving like a squirrel cage induction motor. So whenever there is a cage in the machine and there is a rotating magnetic field, it will machine rotor will rotate in the direction of the rotating field, just like the principle of three phase induction motor. Now, but here also, because we are starting using the damper winding or squirrel cage concept of the induction motor, so the motor will rotate, but it will not rotate at the synchronous speed, because we have seen that induction motor never rotate at the synchronous speed, but almost nearly at the synchronous speed. Now when this comes that, okay, our motor is rotating at suppose 450 rpm and the field speed is suppose 1500 rpm, at this condition we will excite the rotor circuit. Because of this excitation, there will be the formation of poles in the rotor, and that poles will attach with the already rotating magnetic field. And now this induction motor will switch to the synchronous motor, because the rotor will be in synchronism with the rotating field. And third method is starting of synchronous motor against high torque. What is the meaning of high torque? That we will discuss later. But what will we do in the high torque? That high torque means the machine is already having some load. And because of that loading, the simple method like auxiliary method or even induction motor may not work at the high loading condition, because this damper winding method or induction motor starting method is also at no load starting method as at no load condition. Suppose there is already loading, then we use the third method, that is the starting of synchronous motor against high torque. What here we will use the concept of slip ring induction motor. Means slip ring induction motor means in the starting, these rotor winding is placed like this, star connected, and there is a starting resistance and switch is connected to this resistance. Now because of this construction, rotor behaves like slip ring induction motor, and because of this, this motor will have the high starting torque at higher value of the resistance. Once the motor is going to pick up the speed, and when the speed is almost equal to synchronous speed, this switch is thrown to the DC source like this. And at this position, now this field winding, this winding becomes as the field winding with plus and two of winding sorted minus. So at this condition, there will be formation of rotor poles, and that poles will again catch up the rotating magnetic field, and now the machine has shifted from slip ring induction motor to the synchronous motor, and speed is at the synchronous speed. This is one another method of starting when the motor is under loaded condition. What is that? This is known as starting as the super synchronous motor. Here the beauty of this method is that both rotor as well as stator are free to rotate. Stator is suspended in bearing so that it can free to rotate. Means here the stator is also free to rotate, and rotor as usual it is always free to rotate. So here, when we are going to apply three-phase supply, it will be rotating magnetic field in this direction, suppose in anticlockwise direction. Then rotor should rotate in the same direction, but it is not going to rotate because of the inertia, high inertia. Then what will happen? The stator will rotate opposite to the field, opposite to the rotating field. And stator rotates because stator is free to rotate and it is on the bearing and it has no any mechanical loading at present. So it rotates at the synchronous speed opposite to the field speed. And after some time, you have suppose the braking arrangement and going to brake the stator. Whenever you are going to apply the brake, then because of the law of the momentum or physics, apply some physics that the relative speed between the rotor and stator must be same. Suppose stator is going to reduce the speed, then rotor has to rotate in opposite direction of this stator, means in anticlockwise direction, with the same rate as that of we are going to apply the braking on the stator. Means suppose the stator is going to reduce by 10 rpm, then rotor has to rotate 10 rpm in opposite to the stator rotation. Then only there will be concept of the physics that relative speed must be same. And when there is a braking and stator is completely stopped, then rotor will catch up the same speed as that of this stator, and that is the synchronous speed. So this is a used as the super synchronous motor. It is rarely used in day-to-day life. It is mainly used in paper and cement mills. So whenever there is a loading and we have to start this motor as this synchronous machine, we have to run the machine as a synchronous machine, then we are going to adapt this machine. Otherwise, normally we are going to use the same concept as that of induction machine. So this was the one of the starting method, and in the next class we will learn about the next topic, that is the power angle characteristics.